National Science Foundation. His research interests range from network theory to experimental and behavioral economics. He is a research associate at DIW Berlin, Yate, and the Lima School of Economics. He has been a consultant to organizations like the World Bank and the Food and Agricultural Organizations. He has widely published in various journals, and he currently serves on the editorial boards of Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization, Journal of Public Economic Theory, and Studies in Microeconomics. Professor Sarangi, once again, welcome to Presidency.
Thank you.
We also Thank have you, Professor Jonathan Jha from PhD. Thank you. Professor Jha is an assistant professor in the Madden School of Business at Le Moyne College. His research interests lie in the areas of development economics, political economy, and finance. His current research focuses primarily on the issues of gender inequality and corruption. He did his PhD in economics from Louisiana State University, did his post-graduation from Gokhale Institute, and did his undergraduation from Agra University. Professor Jha, once again, welcome to Presidency. So without further ado, I will ask the speakers to start the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chandan, you can start the screen sharing.
Yeah.
So first, I want to thank Zakir and Moshumi and everybody else at Presidency for inviting me and Chandan to do this. And you know, it's a pleasure to be here again. And I must say, I really have to thank Indro for bringing me into this group. So today's talk is, there is this new trend in economics, or actually in gender inequality, which tries to understand the origins of gender inequality from a historical perspective. So when we say arable land in antiquity, you will see it really means, and really in prehistory. And this is not a very difficult talk. The ideas are very simple. We will focus on telling a story. And hopefully we will be able to persuade you. It is a speculative story, because what happened in antiquity, we cannot provide direct proof of that. But it belongs to the same kind of arguments that, you know, that people, Esther Bostrup talked about, for example, that hoe versus plow agriculture. Plow agriculture made a lot of difference to gender inequality and things like that. So this is where this literature is going to come from. I will let Chandan take over, because he's obviously more energetic, more enthusiastic, and a much better presenter than me. So without much ado, I will hand the floor to Chandan. We'll take questions, I think, as we go along. Thank you.
Yeah.
So with that, Chandan, it's yours.
So I will request either write your questions in the chat box, or if Professor Sarangi and Jha likes, they can ask directly to the speakers.
I think we should ask questions as we go along.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everyone, and Safiyati. I did my PhD from LSU, but it is also to be noted that Professor Sarangi is my advisor. So I am his student. Yes. So when I decided to leave LSU, he decided to leave LSU too, because, you know, I had done my PhD. You know? So anyways, thank you very much. So I'll be talking about the arable land in antiquity, and we'll be talking about how does that explain modern gender inequality. So let me very quickly motivate that why gender inequality is important, and a lot of these things I'm simply going to go over because this is very well known, right? So we all know that gender inequality is persistent around the globe, like everywhere. Some, you know, in access to education, labor outcomes like wages, and political representation. So for instance, one of those things is that even now, even today, less than 20% of parliamentary seats are held by women worldwide. At one point in India, you know, they wanted to, they were talking about bringing this bill, right, that would allow women 33% representation, you know, It didn't happen even in India, for example. You know, the representation of women is much less than, I think, 1/3 in the parliaments. This kind of data for wages is not very well available for many developing countries, but we know that in the US or most OECD countries, women are earning generally 10 to 15% less for the same kind of jobs than men. In developing countries, it is estimated that it is even worse. So the reason that gender inequality is very important is not just because, you know, it is important in itself, right? Gender equity is important itself, but it also has some very important economic and, you know, and development implications. And Duflo 2012, actually, in her paper, she talks about all these things, you know, in a very length, right? So it is very, very important implications. So the point being that gender inequality is very important, right? We all know that. And what we also know is that gender inequality across different countries and different societies are markedly different. And so that is something that we want to understand that what happens. So I'm going to talk about the last dimension of gender inequality, which you could call maybe sort of extreme form of gender inequality, that Amart Sen talked about, missing women, where he compared India with, you know, India and China with comparable sub-Saharan Africa, and his finding was that more than 1 million women were missing. So if you actually look at this trend, even the trend doesn't look good. In 2010, for example, right, if you look at male to female ratios, so there were more than 1.1 males in India, and in China it was more than 1.15, although the ideal ratio should be somewhere around 1.05 and 1.06. So that is, you know, coming because of something like, you know, sex selective abortions and, you know, neglected healthcare and so on. So the point being that gender inequality is important and it deserves our attention. So one of the things that you know, economists have done, and that economists or, you know, researchers in general, not just economists, like anthropologists and sociologists, what they have identified is that there are like certain gender norms, right, that exist in the different kind of societies, and they find that the historical agricultural factors have played a role. So what these studies do is that they are looking at the historical agricultural factors, and they are linking these historical agricultural factors with gender norms, and they are looking at two particular, they are dividing the gender inequality in two parts. One is the gender inequality in roles, meaning whether more, you know, whether it is acceptable in the society that women are working in the labor force, for example. That is the primary gender role variable that they have been used. But they have also looked at women, you know, for example, women in parliament. Are we willing to accept women in parliament, you know, as our leaders? Is it acceptable in our society or not? And the other kind of studies have mostly focused on sex ratios and missing women. And they have looked at whether this also relates, you know, this also translates into women's, you know, missing women or sex ratios, or you know, this might also reflect, as I have said earlier, whether women are getting the same kind of health, you know, facilities than men do. So what we do in this paper is that we are going to introduce a very, very important factor, and then that we will talk about, you know, that is an element in all historical factors. So essentially, arable land in antiquity. By arable land in antiquity, what I mean is that the ancestral arable land. And I will show you the exact definition that is. But basically, what just to give you a quick overview. So imagine that I'm talking about, let's say, United States, right? So in the United States, almost everyone, right? There are very few Native Americans, right? But almost, you know, everyone is European, and then there are some other, you know, people from some other parts. So when I say ancestral arable land, I mean the residents of the United States, right? And what kind of land their ancestors enjoyed, yeah? Because we are going to argue that this historical factor, or in this case, arable land in antiquity, impacted gender inequality through a cultural, you know, norm, right? And therefore, what we should be looking at is not the current arable land in the country, but the arable land that the ancestors of the current residents of the country had. Okay, so that is what we are going to be looking at. And we will show that this availability of ancestral arable land is negatively associated with gender inequality index. So we are choosing this gender inequality index because, you know, it accounts for both role and well-being of women. And we know that there is some kind of interaction between the two, right? So actually, we will show that this matters for our story as well. So we'll talk about that. And we show that it is positively associated with women's labor force participation and reproductive health outcome. So that is actually the mechanism and that, you know, it leads to lower gender inequality because, you know, there are more women who are participating in the labor space, and that gives them bargaining power. And it is also positively associated with attitudes regarding women's rights and abilities. So as I said, you know, we were talking about norm. So we will show do three things in detail as we go through the presentation. Okay, so now let me quickly talk about okay. So well, in India we all, you know, someday, you know, we must most of us, we have seen something like this, right? Where the farmer is carrying the plow on his shoulders, right? When he's going to the fields. And Bosrup in 1973 argued is that in societies that practiced plow, in both societies what happened is that women stayed at home performing domestic duties, because in order to operate the plow you needed stronger physical stronger upper body strength, right? And since you need strong upper body strength, men had an advantage in that. So men went work out in the fields while women stayed at home, looked after the children, did other agricultural activities that could be done from inside the home, right? Which was not as, labor intensive. By labor intensive, I mean like, you know, strength intensive. And since this society started doing that, eventually became a cultural belief that it is appropriate for women to stay at home while men will work at home, where men will work at, in the fields. So now, even though the society may not be predominantly agricultural society, right? Even though now there is no use of plow versus hoe, but since it has become a cultural norm, women will stay at home and men will go and work outside in the fields, right? And that field then will, you know, become simply not just fields, but it will become any kind of jobs that are, you know, outside jobs. So, you know, it could be, it could be that, it could be just a corporate job now, right? So even though now you don't have agricultural, society, it would still work. It would still matter. And consistent with this, Elezina, Giuliano, and Nunn, it's a QJE paper. It's already a very famous paper in the last 7 years. So Elezina, Giuliano, and Nunn, they actually show that there are fewer women in the labor force and in parliament in countries where whose ancestors practiced plow. Okay, so they show that, in fact, there is a follow-up paper that they do in 2018. And in that paper, they show that sex ratios are higher in favor of men in countries, again, whose ancestors traditionally practiced plow agriculture. Okay, and they are comparing this plow with hoe agriculture. So that was one paper. On the other hand, Diamond in 1987, he wrote a very influential article. I'm a big fan of that article in Discover magazine. The title of that article is "The Worst Mistake in the History of Human Race." So if you are interested, you might check that out. And where he simply argues that it's not the plow agriculture, but the fact that societies moved to agriculture itself is a factor in creating beliefs about gender roles or gender inequality. So what he argues is that in societies, right, when you had hunter-gatherer societies, what would happen is that you deplete the resources in the area where you are. And when you deplete those resources, you need to move to the new place, right? And when you go to this new place, that means you will have to take all your belongings and your children. And you can't really carry, like, let's say, 3 babies or 4 babies at a time. You would ideally like to have not more than 1 baby that you have to carry all the time. In other words, you don't want to have too many babies. You want to have at least 4 or 5 years gap between two babies, such that the older, you know, the older kid now can walk himself, you know, at least certain distances. On the other hand, when these societies, those societies that moved to agriculture, now they were producing their own food, they could store that. Now they are not depleting the resources that fast, and therefore they don't need to move that soon. Means they could have more frequent pregnancies. That means, well, if you have more babies, if you have babies coming out sooner, of course you need someone to look after them, right? And you know, it is very easy to see that it will be a mom, right? If not for anything, she has to breastfeed, right? So the mom will be there, she will stay at home taking care of the babies, and then the men will be outside. Now, since women started staying at home, that impacted their, you know, bargaining power again negatively, and that would again become eventually ingrained in culture, and that would you know, that would still therefore explain gender inequality through this cultural norm. And Hansen, Jensen, and Skovsgaard actually take this paper, take this idea, and empirically they show that that is indeed true. So that was the second follow-up paper, again very famous paper in the last 5 years, Journal of Economic Growth paper. And they indeed find that the societies that experienced Neolithic transition earlier, in those societies there are fewer women in the labor force. Okay. A follow-up paper by Fredrickson and Gupta shows that those societies also have male to female sex ratios high, again because of the son preference, right? Or you know, simply male dominance. And then we published a paper last year in which we looked at the effect of resources or historical resources, where we basically said that, well, the societies that were endowed with better resources, and we measure the resources simply by the average caloric yield that the society could produce, okay, based on pre-1500, you know, before the Columbian exchange happened, whatever crop was, using that crop, whatever calorie that they could produce. And we showed that the societies that were endowed with better ecological resources, in both societies, there is, you know, there are fewer missing women. Our argument is that, you know, if you had more resources, you really didn't have such a, you know, strong reason to fight for this, you know, intra-household resources, and therefore women received a better share compared to the societies where, you know, there were fewer resources. And since gender inequality was a pre-existing condition, right, so therefore societies that were under resource stress, they allocated relatively greater share of resources, right, to men than women. Okay, in fact, there is a quite a bit of evidence on that that I will actually talk about in a bit now. But now, time to talk about our paper. Okay, so our paper basically can be understood with this simple diagram. So what we are saying is that, you know, you have arable land in NTPT. Now the societies that had greater arable land in NTPT, the simplest thing was that if you have more arable land, that means, you know, you need more people to work in the fields. Okay, so now what happens is that you have the greater demand of labor, therefore what happens is that, you know, you also include women in the labor force. Women also contribute to the labor force. See, if women become part of the labor force, right, then what we know is that they become part of the labor force, and there is quite a bit of studies even today that economic contribution and women's labor force participation, they increase their bargaining power. And because of that, that will impact gender inequality. So essentially, then what we hypothesize is that societies.
Sorry, can I?
Yes.
Can I stop you for a second? I'm not quite convinced by the second causation, the arrow you have from more female labor to having greater bargaining power. You think that's obvious?
I would also like to add one point. For instance, Bina Agarwal argues that it is land ownership which is important. And if you just look at participation in the labor force, it's only a necessary condition, not a sufficient condition for equality.
So I will add two things here. So one is that it's not just, so there are actually, by the way, there might be some studies that might show that it might not impact, but there are also some studies that show that labor force participation does increase their bargaining power. But it's not just the labor force participation, but economic contribution in general. So one of the arguments that we are making is that when women start working in this labor, they start working in agricultural fields, right? They are contributing to something that results in visible, contribution. So in other words, that's a measurable output, right? That is the women's contribution. That's one. And the second thing that I would like to add is that, so let's say even if you did not agree with the second arrow, then there is another mechanism at play. That mechanism at play is that arable land in antiquity, if you are agreeing with the first arrow, then they need more women to work in the labor field, right? So if you agree with the first arrow, then even if you don't agree with the second arrow, then it works in the way is that if you need women to work in the labor force, you want them to be healthy enough, right, to contribute to the agricultural process. So you might provide them with better resources. So that is something that I was going to talk about a bit later. I think Professor Sarangi wants to say something.
No, I'll simply add to unhealthy workers, unhealthy, less productive female workers, rather than feed one and create one healthy female worker.
Sorry, can you repeat that question again?
You are saying that you will invest in health to increase productivity. But rather than increasing productivity, I can compensate productivity with simply a larger number of female workers.
I can maintain my dominance. Sorry, Jacket. Yeah. So I think what is happening here is that it's not really worker as such. It's not really worker as such. It's about the society where you are working as a family in the field, right? So we are talking about a society here where in the family the men and the women, right, both work in the fields, right, and they are bargaining for the intra-household resources. So in that sense, if I know that women are also going to work in the field, right, I need them, for example, I need them to participate in the labor force, and therefore I need them to be healthy enough to contribute in the labor force.
In China and Japan, women participated in very large numbers in economic work. But the gender inequality there is extremely high. How do you account for that?
Professor Sarangi, your microphone is muted.
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, so if I can quickly chime in for a minute. First, why don't you wait to see the point that the mechanism precisely that works in terms of which parts of gender inequality are affected and which parts are not. So let's hang on for a minute. To come to Zaki's point, I want to say that this is not to say that other things are not important. So let's be very clear that inheritance laws and ownership of land, that's a very important mechanism as well. But this is just comparing countries with more arable land to those with less arable land. And then the final comment was about Japan and China. So this is obviously a cross-country study. I can always find new exceptions. So I think that that's not really the point here. The point here is that when you engage in farming practices, what it does. So obviously, there are studies, for example, in China, which shows that rice farming is more cooperative than wheat farming. So in the end, the argument that we are going to make is, if you will allow Chandan a little more time, is to argue that this affects the way it's perceived gender, that puts cultural norms in place, whose effect can be seen even today. In fact, in the other paper, which we also look at within India, we can explain district level variations in the missing women using our mechanism of resource scarcity. So we haven't done that for India here, but we do have a large world value survey data set when we show this. So just hang on a little bit, and then we can come back to these questions.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I think for that one, it would be better. Yeah, thank you. So that is, you know, our main argument here is that if you had more land, you would need more labor. That would promote women's female labor force participation. And when that happens, women will have a greater bargaining power, or you need them to work. Therefore, you are going to care more about their reproductive health outcomes. That's what we are going to show later on. And there are some other studies that have, by the way, shown that if you have a scarcity of land, that actually places a premium on male brawn. That's a book by Iverson and Rosenbluth where she talks about many of these factors. And then there are some other mechanisms. So, for example, one of the mechanisms could be the resource scarcity mechanism, where the idea is that if you have less arable land, that implies a greater resource scarcity, right? And it has been shown, and we actually did in an earlier study, that in societies with greater resource scarcity, there is, greater gender inequality, more missing women to be precise. So I'm going to talk about that a bit here. The reason was that there are many interesting studies here. So the main idea is that if you have fewer resources, then obviously there is going to be a stronger bargaining in the division of intra-household resources, in which men had an advantage because of several reasons. One was that simply gender differences in physical strength. And the second was that simply because gender inequality was a pre-existing condition. And so since gender inequality already existed, that means in times of scarcity, women would receive even less than before. And another thing Hayden talks about in the context of hunter-gatherer societies, he talks about that but mostly hunter-gatherer societies here, that if you live in regions, right, which are resource scarce, then for you it is very, very important that you control number, right? Because if you do not control your numbers, then you all run the risk of dying because of hunger, right? So that means these societies are under greater pressure to control their number. And what they did is that at that time, the most effective way to control their numbers was to simply, resort to infanticides. And, as cruel as it sounds, these guys argue that this kind of responsibility will be actually given to the mother who just gave birth to her child. And how do you really, make that happen? So obviously you have to create a culture where the woman, right, is going to follow male decisions without any question, okay? So that also led to this kind of culture where, this male dominance was developed, all right? And actually, Iverson and Rosenberg also argue that the male competitive advantage in brawn was accentuated by growing land scarcity, which increased the value not only of a man's labor, but also his ability to defend the farm against the marauders, right? So if there is, less land, it's more valuable, there is going to be more, wars between this different societies, and there the male value became even more pronounced. And generally, it has been shown that societies that are exposed to external threats, so something like wars or resource scarcity, these societies enforce existing social norms more stringently. And as I have talked about, it has been, we know that gender inequality actually existed not just in history, but also in prehistory. So let me actually show you now something here. So I am showing you this picture of these two, primates. So can somebody guess what are they like, the left one and the right one? OK, Okay, so one thing that you could probably guess, right? The left one looks violent, right? But the right one looks like a cool, you know, cool guy, right? So, you know, so the difference between the two is that both are actually, the left one is a common chimpanzee and the right one is bonobo. So they are genetically, I don't know, 99.9% similar, okay? But chimpanzees are known for, you know, they are aggressive and their society is known for very high gender equality. On the other hand, bonobos are, you know, they have very, very less gender inequality within them. And researchers have argued that one of the reasons or the main reason behind that is that common chimpanzees are indigenous to regions where there were fewer resources. Okay. And on the other hand, bonobos are found in resource abundant region in Congo, and their society is, you know, less gender equal. So it's just a fun fact. I'm not trying to, you know, draw any conclusions from here. But, you know, there is evidence that resource scarcity played a role in gender inequality, even in primates. Then there is evidence that prehistoric women in the world, you know, parts of the world became shorter relative to men in times of scarcity. So how that was found is that, you know, when you find these bones, the researchers can find what is the male bone versus female bone. And when they compared it, we know certain, you know, certain resource stress that happened in the history. And when the bones of male and female was compared, it was found that women's bones became shorter in times of scarcity than men's, which is actually counterintuitive, because it's men's bones which are more responsive to the nutrition. Okay, so that means it must have been the case that resources were controlled by men even in the prehistory. And as I talked about, in resource-scarce society, even in hunter-gatherer societies, women's domestic and political status were undermined. Okay, so there is quite a bit of literature on that. Okay, so now let me talk about the data that we are using in this paper. We are going to use UNDP Gender Inequality Index that takes values in the range of 0 to 1. Higher values indicate more gender inequality. Okay, so the index is created on the basis of three broad dimensions: health, empowerment, and labor market. The health dimensions include maternal mortality ratio and adolescent fertility rates. Obviously, since there is no male equivalent of that available, right? So that indicator is assigned to different countries against a benchmark of ideal maternal mortality ratio and adolescent fertility rate. Then empowerment includes female and male population with at least secondary education. So the difference between female and male education gap, and the empowerment is women's share in parliament. And finally, the labor market dimension is labor market simply includes, you know, the labor force participation of women. Right, and then there is they take this some kind of inflection into account, and there is some you know, formula that they use, and then they create this gender inequality index. So we use this measure because, you know, when we use this measure overall, then they are taking this inflection into account. But what we are also going to do is that we are also going to look at these roles and outcomes separately. So there are these five dimensions here: maternal mortality ratio, adolescent fertility rate. We are going to look at them. We are going to look at female and male education gap and women share in parliament, which are used as empowerment measure here. And the labor market, female and male labor force participation rates, we are going to look at that separately as well. And then that will tell us a bit of the things that was asked in the question actually. Okay, so this is what it looks like in terms of gender inequality index. It just gives you an idea that, you know, gender inequality, how does it exist? So the darker shade indicates more gender inequality. So as you could see, gender inequality seems less in parts of, you know, European part. In India, you can see quite a bit of gender inequality. Similarly, if you compare Canada and the United States, more gender inequality in the United States than in Canada, and quite a bit of gender inequality in African countries. So it looks like, you know, it does capture what we know. So it looks like that. The ancestral arable land suitable to agriculture data will be used in the fraction. Okay. Yeah. So, Lens Suitable to Agriculture, Elegina, Juliana, and Nunn, we are going to take this data from their QJE 2013 paper. What they are doing is that, what they do is that in each country, they identify ethnic groups. Okay, so what, you know, what are the ethnic groups that are the residents of each country? Once they know the ethnic group, they are going to find that where they originated, where their ancestors came from. And then they will go to that place and then they will look at the 200 kilometer radius of that place and how arable that land is. Okay, so that's how they will calculate the ancestral arable land of each ethnic group. And then to the cultivation of six major crops, by the way. And then what they will do is that they will create a weighted index, right? Weighted index of that ancestral arable land and assign it to a country. And assign it to the country. So that would be the ancestral arable land for the country, okay? We are also going to use the migration adjusted potential arable land. That land arable, you know, arable land data comes from Food and Agriculture Organization. So that is the current land actually. So we are only going to use that. We are only going to use that for robustness checks. Okay. So that land is that land takes into account the major soil constraints such as salinity, global climatic database, and the soil requirements of 21 major crops. What we are going to do is that we are going to adjust it for the migration that has happened since 1500, and we are going to use that as a robustness check, to investigate this relationship. Okay, so our econometric specification is really very simple. Gender inequality index in country I is simply, a function of the fraction of ancestral arable land that suited to agriculture. And then we are going to control for a bunch of contemporary and historical variables. And we are going to do the same thing for robustness check using this migration adjusted potential arable land. I'm not going to, show you a lot of that because, I'm just going to spend more time on the main variable. Okay. So here, let me show you this here. Yes.
Just to clarify, you talked about the ancestral land of different communities, but the gender inequality index is countrywide, right? So do you have the in this equation, are we talking about countrywide data or more specific?
In this equation, we are talking about everything is country-wise. So the fraction of ancestral arable land is basically these guys do, Elezina, Giuliani, and Nunn, they create the ancestral land for each ethnic group, and then they create the weighted average for the country as a whole.
So, I see. Thank you. But big countries like India will have lots of, groups, communities, areas, which are diverse. I'm sure they have done a good job, but I'm just curious.
So, Indra, that is the beauty of this data set. It is amazing what they have done. Apart from the GIS work, for every country, they have found the fraction of ethnic group, and then they have created this for every country. So it is an immense data undertaking.
Yeah, I can imagine. Yeah. Thank you.
So this is cross-country part. We will come to some sub-national part as well, and we will show you some individual level analysis as well. So what we see here is, basically the crux of our paper in these two figures is that what we see is that ancestral arable land across countries is negatively associated with gender inequality index. Obviously, there is quite a bit of, countries are here and there, but the trend is clear, right? There is a clear negative trend. And then in the next one, what you can see is that countries that have greater ancestral arable land, they have that have greater female male labor force participation gap. So here I'm talking in relative terms because female male labor force participation gap is what is used in the calculation of GII. So I took it from there. And you see that societies that had greater ancestral arable land, in those societies, there are more women working in the fields relative to men. So now I'm going to show you some results here. Okay, so the first result here, you know, we start with so we have a baseline control. Let me just talk about stuff at the bottom. The baseline controls are going to be, of course, we want to include current income, right? Because it's possible that countries that have better arable land today, maybe it is capturing the current economic environment. So we control for that. We control for land area in geographical tropics, distance to nearest coastline or sea navigable river. So we control for these variables. They are our baseline control variables, which we'll include in all the specifications. So then what we see is that ancestral arable land is negatively associated with gender inequality index. Then we are going to include the three main variables that have recently been shown to impact gender inequality, the historical variables. So we start with including ancestral plow use. Then we include years since Neolithic transition. Again, it is adjusted for migration. So all of these variables are ancestral in that sense. And then I have pre-1500 average crop yield. I include all those things and we find the same thing that ancestral arable land is negatively associated with gender inequality index. Actually, in the last column, what we do is that we control for a lot of variables. We control for share of agriculture in GDP and industry. We control for religious fractionization. We control for democracy. We control for state antiquity index, legal origins, social infrastructure index, as well as the experience of communism, right? Because many of these variables have been argued to, you know, have an impact on gender inequality in some or other way. So we have control for all these variables in the last specification. We still see that there is a significant relationship between ancestral arable land and gender inequality. All right. So and then the next specification, since we are arguing that the main channel was the female labor force participation, we can show you here is that ancestral arable land is positively and significantly associated with the female labor force participation in all these specifications. They are the same specification as we see in the as we saw on the previous screen. We do want to mention here is that maybe somebody might argue that could be that this ancestral arable land is highly positively associated with current arable land, right? And it's possible that we see this positive relationship because of the omission of that current arable land. I could show you, and I will probably show you a bit later on, that when I include the current potential arable land in the same equation, the ancestral arable land remains significant throughout. So does current arable land, but both of them stay statistically significant and economically sizable. Okay. In other words, these results are not driven due to the omission of the current arable land. Okay. So another thing that we wanted to check, that was one way. And then what we did is that, okay, let's look at this relationship between ancestral arable land and gender inequality, and then include female labor force participation in control variable, right? And see if that does play a mediating role. And as you can see, the moment we control for the female labor force participation, the relationship between ancestral arable land and gender inequality goes away. It's not significant in either of the specifications. So basically, so far, what we want to say here is that what we find is that ancestral arable land is negatively associated with gender inequality index. Primary mechanism is the labor force participation. And the secondary mechanism, as we talked about, we just call it a secondary mechanism, which is resource scarcity, because we do find some evidence that resource scarcity might be playing a mediating role here, because when we control for the, when we control for the resource environment using the ancestral crop yield, what we find is that the coefficient does become a bit smaller and it does become a little less statistically significant. but we are calling it only a secondary, you know, secondary mechanism, because it does not it does not explain the relationship the way the female labor force participation is, where including the female labor force participation, this result simply becomes statistically insignificant, and you know, the coefficients are also much smaller than they were, like, you know, they are cut almost in half in most specifications. Okay, so then what we wanted to see is, we wanted to look at these components separately. All right, so remember that this was made on the basis of the gender inequality index was computed on the basis of a health dimension, which includes adolescent birth rate, number of births per thousand women of ages 15 to 19, maternal mortality rate, which is the number of maternal deaths per 100,000 live births. And then empowerment dimension includes share of women in parliament and female-male secondary education gap. And then labor force, labor market dimension, which is the female-male labor force participation gap. When we look at this separately, this is like all the baseline specifications. So when we look at them separately, what we find is that ancestral arable land is negatively associated with maternal mortality rate and adolescent birth rate. Okay, so these are the health dimensions. So this is what I was talking about, that, you know, in order for women to work in the field, you needed them to be healthy enough, right? So in other words, you know, you would actually even want women to have less frequent pregnancies if you need them to work in the fields, and therefore the maternal mortality rate and adolescent birth rate will be smaller. On the other hand, women in parliament gap is not impacted. Again, which makes sense, because in historical times, why do you need women to be educated, right? Or why do you need women to be politically strong to work in the fields? Since you did not do, since you did not need that, you know, you didn't create, you didn't develop that kind of culture. And even today, you do not see this variable to be positively associated with women in parliament or education gap. On the other hand, it is again strongly associated with female level, you know, labor force participation gap in favor of women. So labor force participation gap is female labor force participation gap minus male labor force participation gap. Again, I would just mention that if I included the current potential arable land, I would find the same thing. Actually, if anything, I would find that ancestral arable land is more strongly associated with female labor force participation today than current arable land. That shows the primacy of, you know, ancestral arable land, means that it is working through its effect on culture. All right, now let's talk about the attitudes. We talk about attitudes for two reasons. One, because it allows us to look to use the individual level data, and two, because that, you know, a lot of the effects that we are seeing is happening through attitudes itself, right? Because the norm is more closely to be associated with gender attitudes. So we are going to do that using the World Value Survey individual level data, and we are going to use the following three variables. The first is the attitudes regarding women's rights. So in the World Value Survey, they asked respondent, when jobs are scarce, men should have a greater right to a job than women. You can disagree or you could agree, so 0 and 1 coded. Attitudes regarding women's abilities. On the whole, men make better politicians than women do. Now again, strongly disagree, disagree, agree, and agree strongly. So you could see, by the way, and maybe some of you might have a question on my empirical strategy here. So I will talk about that. So you could see that even though they are categorical variable, they are following like 1, 2, 3, 4. They are in the, you know, they are numerically consistent in a hierarchical order. Okay. And whether a woman is a part of the labor force, that is yes. If she is not a part of the labor force, that is no. We are going to do that. So essentially, we are going to estimate this equation where the outcome is going to be, so why, for example, let's say if I'm talking about, you know, the respondent's opinion about whether men should have a greater right to a job than women, then the response of individual I in district D in country C is going to be a function of ancestral enablement that is measured at district level, district D in country C. So I should have a subscript C here. In district D, I am going to control for a bunch of individual level variables and district level variables. And then in some specifications, I will control for the country dummies to capture the country fixed effects. And in other specification, I will control for country level variables. So the individual level controls are going to be age square, dummies for primary and secondary education, gender, and dummy for being married. For district level controls, there will be ancestral plow use, fraction of ancestral land that was tropical or subtropical, ancestral domestication of large animals, ancestral settlement patterns, and ancestral political complexity. Now, I must here mention, I didn't mention here, so I must here mention is that what I'm showing you in this table, what I'm showing you in this table is exact table, not the exact table, but the exact specification from the QJE 2013. Okay, so in the QJE 2013, Alizina et al. Have done the exact same regressions, exact same thing, except their variable of interest was plow variable, and they are not reporting the ancestral land, just like I'm not reporting the plow variable. They are only reporting plow variable while they are controlling these variables as control variables. So since their data is publicly available, we took that data and we ran that regression. Okay, and so we were able to just match that, okay, this is exactly the same table. Actually, this is table 5 or something that is noted in the paper, by the way. So what do we find here? We find that societies that have better ancestral arable land, in those societies, people are less likely to agree that men make better political leaders than women do. Okay. So that is true even when we control for the country fixed effects. So in other words, at least in this specification, country specific factors are not a concern. Okay. Then in the second specification, same thing what we see, ancestral arable land is negatively associated with the response, right, that people would agree that when jobs are scarce, men should have a more right to a job. So people do not agree with, you know, in those societies, again, we are controlling for country dummies. When we look at the female labor force participation, what we find is that greater ancestral arable land is positively associated with female labor force participation. But when we control for the country dummies, that result goes away. Which, by the way, could be because there is not a lot of variation in many countries for the ancestral arable land at district level. But again, this is something, that is a bit different. But overall, these results tell you that residents of the regions whose ancestors were allowed with better arable land, they are less likely to agree with the statement that men have greater right to a job than women in times of job scarcity. They are less likely to agree with the statement that men make better politicians than women do. And, you know, it's generally there are more women in the labor force in those countries. Okay. So now we could talk about, since I'm running out of time, right? I have maybe 10 more minutes. Jackie, do I have 10 more minutes?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yeah, definitely.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. So what I'm going to do is that now, you know, one of the things that we wanted to see is that talk about the historicity of arable land, right? So whether the arable land, you know, the arable land that we have, they actually, you know, capture the historicity. So in order to do that, what we did is that we did migration unadjusted potential arable land, right, versus, let's say, migration adjusted potential arable land. So the idea is that you have countries in the Americas and Oceania, right, where nobody, right, or very few people, right, where very few people are natives, right? So in those countries, what you see is that when I do migration adjusted potential arable land, there is no difference between countries in Americas and Oceania and other countries, because again, in these countries, there is no one native, so that makes sense. On the other hand, when we do the ancestral arable land here, or the migration adjusted arable land, I was just moving between these two slides. So So the idea is that this is the migration unadjusted potential arable land. In this case, the land is not adjusted for migration. So when we look at the countries in the Americas and Oceania, there are nobody in these countries, or there is very few people who are actually natives. So if I sum these two things up, they will add up to zero. In other words, there is no difference. On the other hand, when we look at ancestral arable land, and in these countries, since ancestral arable land and the migration adjusted arable land, both of them takes into account the fact that this has already been adjusted for migration, or it is talking about ancestral arable land, then since in these countries, nobody is, or very few people are natives, we see that it is simply insignificant. We also looked at, so these are like some sensitivity check. We looked at gender development index and female-male life expectancy gap. We find the same thing. Societies, with greater ancestral arable land have both better gender development index and better female-male life expectancy gap at birth, right? So women are, women life expectancy is greater in those societies relative to men in which there were roots ancestors enjoyed more arable land. Okay, now let's talk about one more thing about an effect of culture. So what we are arguing again is that the ancestral arable land has an effect on modern gender inequality via an effect on culture. If that is correct, then what we should find is that ancestral arable land should have a primacy over current overland, over current potential arable land. And that is what we exactly find. What we find is that when we do a horse race between ancestral arable land and currently potential arable land, what you see is that ancestral arable land can explain GII as well as health dimensions, but current potential arable land is not significantly associated with either maternal mortality rate or adolescent birth rate. Okay, we had already shown that ancestral arable land is not significantly associated with empowerment outcome. On the other hand, for labor force participation gap, both of them are positively and strongly associated. So in other words, while the current potential arable land might indicate that there are more women working in the field or working in agriculture because there is more land now, the ancestral arable land shows the effect of cultural norms that even after controlling for current potential arable land, ancestral arable land is positive and statistically significant. Moreover, it is also, like almost 10 percentage points. So essentially, it shows that, norms are important even today. So ancestral arable land does capture the land. Now, another thing that we talked at the beginning is that arable land in antiquity is a complementary input to all these historical factors, right? So then, we should also see that when we pit all these historical variables together in the regression, it should be important. And that's what we find here. Here, what we did is that we included all the historical variables that have been identified by current literature. And what we find is that it is only ancestral arable land that is significantly associated with gender inequality index. We are controlling for continent dummies in all this specification. Then ancestral arable land is also significantly associated with maternal mortality rate and adolescent birth rate. Besides ancestral arable land, only ancestral plow use is shown to be negatively associated with adolescent birth rate. We have been arguing anyways that ancestral arable land should not matter for women empowerment, so it is not significantly associated with that. On the other hand, we do find that here, since Neolithic transition is significantly associated with education, female-male education gap. I'm not going to interpret any of those things. What we simply wanted to see here is that, again, ancestral arable land is positively associated with labor force participation gap, statistically significant. And then transition to agriculture is negatively associated with that, and so on. So what we essentially see is that it does look like that ancestral arable land is most significant correlate of gender inequality index and its variables, specifically the ones that we argue, than other variables. So so that's our result. So now I can quickly conclude. So let me start with that, you know, we argue that the availability of arable and in antiquity played a role in the shaping of gender norms, which promoted women's labor force participation and resulted in better reproductive health outcomes for them. It does continue to affect these outcomes even today. So now, since we find that it affected women's reproductive health outcomes and not empowerment measures, well, there is a reason, you know, there is a good reason that this might be happening. That's because in societies in more arable land, you know, with more arable land, if you needed more women in agriculture, then, you know, you are going to be, you know, provide them healthy enough. Actually, more importantly, you might want to have, you know, a greater distance between, you know, pregnancies, right? And that might itself impact maternal mortality rate and adolescent birth rate, which is what we see. And of course, these things eventually became ingrained in culture, which is prevalent even today. And finally, so where do we go with that? We know that these cultural norms are there. So does that mean that, you know, there all that is bad means, you know, it continues affecting gender inequality even today for last several hundred or even thousand years? So what do we do? So, well, so good thing about is that, you know, norms are sticky, not static. We know that. In fact, gender inequality has probably narrowed a lot more in last 20, 30 years than it did in previous 100 years, mostly because of, you know, it could have been because of, you know, technology, for example. So there could be several technologies that, you know, reduce women's time for household chores, right? So they allowed women to work outside. In fact, there have also been like some, you know, technological change that have been sort of biased in favor of women. So for instance, you know, many of services jobs that can be done on the computer, you don't really need male brawn anymore. So there are all those things. So there can be, you know, some policy implications. It's not all, you know, it doesn't mean that all hopes are lost, by the way. So thank you. Now, you know, you can ask any additional questions.
So can I take 2 minutes?
Thank you. Yeah.
So first I want to thank everybody. And actually, it was an honor to have Professor Amir Bagchi here, although he has left now. This was the first time, at least I had virtually an opportunity to present in front of him. So thank you very much. I just want to conclude by saying, look, what we are trying to do is tell you a very speculative story. It is not that given the data limitations of such a story, it is not that we can give you very strong evidence, that we are able to persuade you through tackling this problem in many different ways. So let me just lay out what I think is the key features, sort of as a concluding remark. So there are a number of people who have tried to explain how things related to agriculture, like the crop output, the calorific output of the crop, the years transition to agriculture, so how long people have been doing agriculture or hoe versus plow agriculture. The thing is, all of these things seem to matter for current gender inequality. But if you think, you realize that land is what ties all of these things together. And this wonderful variable of land, which is very difficult and detailed work, has been done by Alessina Giuliano and Nunn. So we take that, because land is the one that ties everything together. We put that into the regression. We pretty much follow a lot of the strategies that other people have exploited to try and build a convincing story. We try to do a lot of checks and balances to see if then outcomes. And what happens is many of these studies either look at an outcome variable or they look at attitude variables. The other thing that we have tried to do as sort of a stress test for our story is to have both these outcome variables as well as these attitude variables. The attitude variables from the World Value Survey, the outcome variables is the gender inequality index. And then we do the aggregate gender inequality index as well as its components. And it is when we get to the components that the story becomes interesting. It seems that labor force participation is a critical element, and the components that affect labor force participation seem to bear out, the others don't. So in that sense, that's my brief summary of the paper. So I'm trying to create a takeaway. I hope we have been able to persuade you with the story, and we will take questions.
Thank you, Professor Sarangi, for the final briefing. So as he said, he's ready to take questions. So anybody with any clarifications or questions?
May I kick off?
Yes, Indra. I would not expect any less.
Well, even if I'm convinced and persuaded by your study, first of all, it's a nice study, so full stop. But obviously, it raises lots of discussions. I'm not an expert at all, but I'm. But still, you have done a better homework than
I. Yeah, yeah, so. No. But it's good to have questions.
So I wonder whether you didn't talk about gender pay gaps. Obviously, in history, there was no payment as such. Participation is kind of 0-1. But now a bigger question is, like you had, participation in parliament as an indicator, people talk about pay gaps more than participation. So I wonder if that can be somehow brought into the analysis. So, so carry on. Like I can ask 10 different questions, but more for Adda than serious thoughts. But this is, I think, is...
Yes, a very quick answer. Then you can go to the next question. So actually, there are many different measures of gender inequality. And I think you are right. We have chosen one that has not been used. But I'm sure when we go through the review process, referees will ask us to do other robustness checks and if it will hold. So I think data is available. We could do this. We have not done this. I mean, the real question is we want to see, because you know there are many different variables with which you can measure gender inequality. So we thought we will stop somewhere and let the review process throw up some at us, and then we will go with those.
Very nice. Well, you are the editor, so you know.
No. So, but I can tell you, I mean, so, Indra, no, that's not the issue. The issue is there are at least 10 other measures we can think of.
Yeah, absolutely.
So where do we stop? You know, where do we stop the paper? Because, so we thought, okay, we will stop here, see what people want us to do. And most of, the, like, gender pay gap and all, we can get the data, at least for a large number of countries, and it can be done. We don't know the answer, whether it will be true or not, but, you know, it can be done.
Okay, I'll stop by making another comment. You know, your individual responses. If we did that survey in my ancestral village in Bardhaman district in West Bengal, which is perhaps one of the most productive districts in the world, I doubt you will get desirable answers.
I would not disbelieve you, but that is something we have to tell World Value Survey people. Actually, I don't know. Maybe Chandan, you can pull up what is... So here, Chandan, here is some homework for you. Please pull up the Indra's district and give him the answer. Later, not now. Pull it up and email the answer to him and me.
Okay, well, so it depends that World Value Survey was done in his district or not, because it doesn't do in every district. So you have to think, you know. So yeah, it may be, it may not be.
Yeah, okay, overall you know, Ganges Valley in Bihar, Bengal.
No. Let him give us all the districts in Bengal.
No, so at some point, Professor Sarangi mentioned that, but in our general population economics, actually, we had done the same thing in the district level analysis in India, and we had found that those societies which could produce more calorific yield, in those societies, sex ratio is in favor of women. So we had done that for India on subnational analysis.
Okay, thank you.
Chandan, you will provide us this. The response to this question. Indra, I'm having fun.
But one thing, so you need to tell me which district is from. I don't know which district is from though.
Well, just look at the map, pick any district that Ganges goes through. Essentially, okay. That's the you know, most fertile. I mean, this, this is true for any civilization from Amazon to Ganges.
Yeah. All the big rivers. Then you have to do something like a regression discontinuity design. The closer you are to the river, what happens then is you move further away from the river. That would be another way to look at this data. Chandan, Indra has given you a new idea.
Okay.
Hello, Chandan. So what is the logic behind the relationship between productivity and gender inequality?
So the idea is that, you know, if women are working, you know, outside, right? And if they're making economic contribution, okay? So that economic contribution should give them some bargaining power in the allocation of intra-household resources.
Where is the bargaining power? Within the household or in market?
Yeah, within the household, yeah. So if you are contributing more, you know, if you are contributing more within the household, right, by by working in agriculture where you are producing measurable output, right?
When a female work in field, so actually total contribution is not divided at all in between male and female. It is very difficult to separate the contribution. Actually, in farmer family, it is not calculated what is the contribution of female and what is the contribution of male.
Yeah, well, you might not exactly separate, right? You might not exactly point that, okay, this much is coming from male or versus female, right? But you are at least, when you compare two societies where women are not working versus a society where women is, you know, women are working, right? Then at least you see that women are making contribution.
No, so actually, another way to think about this, I will argue, is that you look at, you're absolutely right that they don't say, okay, this is the output you produce and this is the output I produce. That's sort of very, Western industrial way of thinking, okay? But what is being argued here is that when you do household work, there is no market value that can be placed on it. Whereas agricultural output is something that is visible, that has a market value. And so if you are contributing to that, even if you what is relative to household chores or domestic housework, you have a bigger economic contribution, which changes your ability to bargain for resources within the household. So what do we mean by that? For example, it is well known that if mothers are more educated, outcomes for children in terms of health and education are generally better. Okay, why? It just changes the bargaining for resources within the household. So that's kind of the argument we are trying to make. So the benchmark is that you do not produce this type of output.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you, Shubhrata. Any other question?
I just have some clarificatory questions, if I may.
Please, Zakir.
One is, that it may be a bit naive, but I would really like to have a look at the data, the mean, the variances of the variables that have been used in the analysis. I mean, before running an OLS, I think if you, I mean, these things are should be looked at a bit more carefully. If you can go back to the fits, the graphs, for instance. Please, Chandan.
Yeah, I'm going there.
Yeah.
No, I can also summary statistics if you want to look at.
Yeah, please.
You have the summary statistics, maybe you can show it.
Yeah, would you like me to move to that?
Yeah, please.
Okay.
So I just want to say I chose this paper because I thought that this will generate discussion.
No, it's very interesting.
It's a speculative story.
All right, can you see the summary statistics?
Not yet. Now we can. Zakir, we'll send you the paper. I mean, we can, you can see now, but you know, we'll send you the paper.
I think that would be best. Let's skip the first question then. What I wanted to ask is, and then I'll have three more questions. One is that you are not including culture for obvious reasons, I think, in the equation, right? But culture itself, the way that you have framed the paper, is being affected by one of the explanatory variables.
Yes.
So in that case, there will be endogeneity in the model.
Yes. But if you have a measure of culture you want us to think about, we will be happy to think about it.
An index of culture, you have to account for this endogeneity.
Yeah, I agree. But I mean, I'm saying if you suggest it, we will see what we can do about it or how to think about it and whether we can use it or not. So, I mean, you know, we haven't thought in that direction because we wanted to rule out culture. But if you suggest something, we'll try to see what can be done. I mean, we're happy to take suggestions about these ideas.
And in one of the specifications, we are controlling for religious fractionalization index.
Yes, that is kind of a measure of culture, to the extent that religion is a measure of culture.
It is culture, but it is not, you would say, that part of culture which affects gender.
One more thing
I would like to add. So many a times, you know, in the literature, the culture is captured using the proportion of population in different religions. And when we do that, we still find that our results are significant, though it becomes a bit smaller, which is obviously for the obvious reasons, right? Because if it has an effect on, you know, through culture, right, then controlling for a cultural variable should diminish the effect.
In fact, Zakir, I want to tell you one thing we speculate about in the paper. So we argue that, you know, people, if you look at countries with similar income equality, sort of similar per capita incomes, but differentiate them on the basis of these land ideas, we will see that it turns out that countries with Islam have more gender inequality. But it also turns out that these countries have less arable land. So we are in fact saying it's entirely possible that Islam's attitude towards women arises because of less arable land rather than the other way around. So maybe because religions often tend to incorporate the existing culture. So for example, you know, Christianity has taken up many of the pagan festivals. Then Hinduism tries to incorporate Buddhism into it. So religions try to absorb existing culture. So in fact, we argue that one possibility is that countries where Islam is predominant also tend to have maybe more gender inequality simply because they have less arable land.
Yeah, but Hinduism, I think, is the dominant religion in India, which has a lot of arable land. And
I'm not saying that. So the point there is that, you know, people should think carefully about attributing things to religion. We are saying that maybe arable land explains a lot of these things. This is comparing countries with similar per capita incomes.
I don't know if you see that figure on the screen right now. Do you see the figure, GDP per capita and 2012 gender inequality index?
Yeah.
So that's the figure that we are talking about. So for example, you know, if you compare, let's say, Norway with Qatar, right? Both have, or even Qatar with Switzerland, they have similar level of, you know, like GDP per capita, but gender inequality in Qatar and Saudi Arabia and Oman, compared to, for example, Oman and Slovenia, right? Oman has much higher gender inequality index, even though it's a similar level of GDP per capita. But so we are arguing that it's not because of the religion, but it's because of, you know, the fact that Oman and Saudi Arabia and Qatar, all of them actually have a much less ancestral arable land compared to Slovenia, Norway, or Switzerland, for example?
Yeah, but if you bring in India, China, what would be the...
Yes, but China's gender inequality is much better than India. Much, much better. If you remember the Clerplet map that Chandan showed.
But, I mean, if you go back historically, let's say 100, 150 years ago, was it very high? I would doubt it. In the last century, beginning of the last century.
I don't know. I mean, it's just, we're just saying that it is possible maybe that instead of attributing things to religion, one should be thinking about these agricultural factors.
Yeah, I mean, what I would say is that maybe OLS is not a good vehicle to test out your theories. Mm. It has got so many problems. It may be better to go for, to bring in an instrumental control for the impact of culture. And I mean, obviously,
that I'm not disagreeing. So that's what I'm saying. So what kind of culture measure would you like us to consider? You can email, Zakir. I mean, later if you think of something, we'll try to address it.
To bring in culture, you have to control, you have to address the issue of endogeneity through an instrument.
I don't disagree.
Achha, the next question is, it's related to what Shuprabhat argued. I think the basic argument is the Sen's argument that the fallback position of the woman improves, and if she works, and so she, her bargaining power in intra-household bargaining process goes up.
That's basic argument, yes.
Agarwal's argument that she recognizes her worth, the family recognizes her worth, and because of this, her bargaining power goes up. And she can bargain and improve her position. But again, I mean, I think that... I mean, just if you relate increasing workforce participation and a favorable gender outcome, that is, I think, more subtle. I mean, if you can think of the IT sector where women are working, they're working and getting a very high income. But if you look at the key studies of the IT sector, there's a lot of gender inequality. Gender inequality within the IT sector, within their homes. So just a workforce participation, higher wages, I think it's a bit more complex than that.
No, so I totally agree that it's complex, but I think that it is still a bit, you know, I think that overall the idea is that, you know, if women are working and making economic contributions, right? I think it is sort of established that this does lead to at least some improvement in their status. So for instance, you know, again, if you compare, for example, IT sector women, right? What if, you know, the interesting comparison would be that you are comparing those IT sector women to the next door family, which is in the same society, right? Which has the same standard, you know, like same society or same city or something like that, you know? And whether that woman who is staying home all the time, if she enjoys the same kind of, you know, same kind of power as an IT sector woman who is working, I doubt. I mean, I still think that, you know, the woman who is working outside, she has a bit of more freedom and more, you know, bargaining compared to.
Actually, Zakir, let me put it slightly differently. So I think you're absolutely right that Sen's argument is the heart of it. Then there is papers by Seema Jayachandran, Rachel Heath, and so on. Actually, Seema Jayachandran has done a lot of work on this. And she argues that labor force participation improves the bargaining power of women. But the point we are trying to make very simply is that in antiquity, arable land led to a certain type of culture. In fact, I will argue that if I look at the IT sector, it's not inconsistent with our story, because what we are saying, we're not talking about what is happening today. We are saying, if you have created a culture where there is inequality, then even if you're working in the IT sector, it does not matter. You are still vulnerable or exposed to that type of inequality. We're just saying that there is a culture which has been created by agricultural practices in the past, whose effect is still present today. And in fact, it is building on stories that have already been published by bringing in the one fact that ties all of them together, or if I borrow a Lord of the Rings analogy, the one ring that holds them together, which is land, because they've looked at the agricultural technology, they've looked at the transition to agriculture, and they've looked at the output. But this is the one that brings all of them together. So that's, we thought it is an obvious question. We were surprised that nobody did this, actually, because the obvious question would be to see how land will affect everything. So I don't see necessarily a conflict that in spite of higher wages, there is, there is inequality. Because as we said, norms are sticky. They're not static, they change over time, but they're sticky.
Hello. One point is that participation, women participation and productivity are not highly related. If you compare Bardhaman district and Purulia, in Purulia district, women participation in agriculture is very high compared to Bardhaman. But in Bardhaman district, productivity is very high compared to the productivity of agriculture in Purulia. So therefore, it is not necessary that if productivity is high, that means women's participation in agriculture is high and their bargaining power will increase in within the family. So there is no relationship between the contribution of women and the productivity. Which
We're not making an argument about productivity, an argument about participation. Especially if you think about ancestral agricultural technology, there is not much to talk about in terms of the difference in technology that would lead to changes in productivity. So the argument is numbers. It is not about productivity as such. I don't think we are using the word productivity anywhere.
Actually, in your first equation, I have seen that there is a relationship between yield, that is output, I think, per capita output and not. What was that?
So that was just a control variable that we have used, and that is supposed to measure the historical resources in the past and not really the productivity. And that is not, the control variable that we have used. That is not, we are not actually making any comment specific to productivity.
So let me be very clear. Let me explain. Chandan, can you go to that slide? So that is saying, what is the agricultural output in measured in calorie? Yes. That's the one you're referring to, I think, in caloric terms of six pre-Columbian crops. So it is really a measure of nutritional content of the food. It is not the agricultural productivity as such that is being measured there. What you are measuring there is trying to capture the caloric content of the output.
Average crop yield.
Yeah, so this crop yield is not capturing the productivity, but it is capturing the resource environment in the past.
This is my question. What is the relationship between the gender inequality and this variable? It is a negative, okay?
Negative.
My question is, what is the logic behind this? Is it your control variable?
Yeah, this is
in
a
this paper, it is a control variable. Yes. This is addressed in the other paper. Chandan, if you want to go ahead and explain, please do so.
Yes. So for that one, the argument here is, let me go back here. So the argument
is the same one as you use for the primates. It's the same argument for primates.
For the primates, yeah. So the argument basically is that, you have this resource scarcity. If you have fewer resources, right, fewer subsistence resources, then there is going to be greater bargaining for the allocation in the intra-household resources. And in that bargaining, men had an upper hand for two reasons. First was simply because gender inequality was a pre-existing condition. So men already had an upper hand. And the second was also because men had you know, men had an advantage in the physical strength. So there the argument lies for the fact that you have, you know, the subsistence resources are low. So imagine, for example, we have like one pizza and we are two pizza, right? Well, both of us can eat, and you know, we don't have to find out who gets more slices, right? As long as we are all fed. But now I have only one pizza, and there are five family members or six family members in my house. Now do I really need to make choices of who gets two slices? Let's say there are eight slices. Is that the man or is that the woman? But if there is only one pizza, why do we care? Everybody gets, you know, as much they need. So that's the idea. So in societies where there was not enough food, there would be a bargaining for resources. In the societies where there was already enough, we don't need to do that.
So, I am going to suggest that we need to wrap up in or so, because I have another meeting at 10:45. But Chandan can stay, actually. I don't mind.
Okay, just ask one quick question, please.
Yes, sir. Yes, please.
You're talking about the long arm of history, right?
Yes.
100 years, 150 years is nothing in this. If you had regressed, run the regression 150 years ago, would you have got the same result?
This is a perfect question for this entire literature. Unfortunately, how do we get a measure of gender inequality 100? So this is the question that, you know, when I read this literature, and when Chandan and I started working on this, this is one of the first, why forget about 100 years, 150 years ago? I would even like to see if I can find reasonable measures of gender inequality at the global level 50 years ago. You know, 150 years ago would be great. And we would like to do this, because that's exactly what we really want to do.
No, I mean, you can classify the groups of countries based on their, instead of a continuous variable, you can just classify them into two or maybe three or four groups and run an ordered probit model, something like that. And this classification has to be based on sociological literature, historical literature.
That actually does sound interesting. It should be, you know, I don't know, it might be possible. I don't know. So I will look into that. That does sound interesting. And, you know, if we can do that, that would be actually, you know.
Yeah, and that will be a contribution to this literature, because nobody has done this. And I really think it is important.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, no, that was a very good point.
You know, and ideally, what you want to measure it 150 years ago, 500 years ago, and so on, and see if that same story holds.
Yeah, that will give the robustness of your results.
Absolutely.
Oh, very good. Shaha has requested for your paper.
Jakir, can I send you the paper, and then, you know, you can share with everyone? Or, of course, my email ID is, I'm expecting my email ID. And so that, you know, if you're interested in my paper, please send me an email, and I'll be happy to share the paper. And I'm definitely going to share the paper with Zakir, so you can also contact him and get the paper from him. But, you know, send me an email, and I'll be happy to send you the paper.
Yeah. Thank you, Chandan. Quite an interesting question answer session. So, anybody, any other questions?
I mean, I just hope we gave everybody something to think about. I know that we don't have perfect answers, but, you know, it was an attempt to engage people and make people think about something differently.
It's a very interesting book.
Yeah, and there was like some very good discussion. I really liked the discussion that we had here. Especially that nobody's in a hurry that, okay, we have to run away, right? So many a time we read papers, by the time it's over, like, people are like, okay, I have to go away, I have to, you know, I have to go and all that. So very good discussion. I really like this.
No, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
And Indra, thank you for kicking it off as always.
Thank you. Chandan, you probably haven't heard of Bengali Adda enough. You know, get us going. We can be here for 3-4 hours.
Yes, I know. That's why I said I have another meeting at 10:45. And so I have another 5 minutes in which to exit and get to the other meeting.
Professor Sarangi, next time when Indrajit sends his paper to Jibo, and if it comes to you, send me for review.
Well, at least it will not be desk rejected then.
There you go. Chandan, I'm sorry to say, you have to first prove that you are capable of reviewing Indra's paper.
No, come on.
Yeah, but you send me and then we'll see, right?
Anyway, thank you both. It was really lovely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sudipta. Thank you, Chandan. It was a wonderful conversation, and very good discussion too. So thank you, everybody. So I hope again we will get chance to interact once again in future days. Okay. So bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Pushkar is presenting next Friday. Okay, Zakir has an announcement.
Yeah, Pushkar is presenting.
The topic is fantastic.
But it will be, late at night, midnight for you.
Yeah, I know. But the topic is fantastic.
Yeah, but hopefully we'll be able to record that.
Yes, and I will tell Pushkar. Anyway, I will tell Pushkar he has to give you permission to record so we can see it.
Yeah. I mean, if he allows it, even for, we can distribute it to specific persons, maybe he'll allow that.
I will tell him that it is in the middle of the night, so please allow recording so that we can listen.
Yeah, so that's also in history.
Yeah, railway.
Yeah,
that, on railways. Okay, so bye everybody, and I'll request my auntie to stay for a while because I have to discuss one point with them. Okay. So, bye.